mine is Dr. Paul Hillmer. How many of you know that Dr. Hillmer played guitar? A handful of you. This is a thrill for me to play, to have him play and to play with him. He has picked out a Bible verse and a song for today. The song that he picked up for today is called The Summons. It happens to be also a song that was sung at my wedding, or in my family we refer to it as Amy's wedding. So you're invited to join us in the song. Please rise, and we'll sing all five verses.
Maybe see it.
play with you and make you like, let's start with the song. One of your favorite songs? Are you one, by the way?
Well, technically, it looks like it. I'll just speak louder.
You picked the song for a chapel today. Why is this one of your favorites?
Well, I love meaningful songs. And this is going to make me sound really old and maybe a little judgmental. Please forgive me. Just think a lot of the songs we sing now don't have much depth. They kind of say one thing. And quite often, what they say are things that if people are looking at from the outside, they just look kind of mean and desperate and kind of pathetic. Pardon me for saying that a little too strongly. But God, I run to you. I hide in your presence. I think only you can save me. Those things are all true. Don't get me wrong. But sooner or later, when you get as old as I am, I don't see how old that is. You know, you want to think about something bigger. You want to think about something more meaningful. You want to put your faith into action in a meaningful and helpful and constructive and positive way. I think this is one of the songs that makes me think about that. It
certainly is. Like I mentioned, the same phrase, which I was a participant in. Philippians 1:21, one of your favorite Bible verses, Philippians 1:21, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is
gain. Yeah. Well, you know this as well as I do. You know, you lose a parent, and you think about, you know, how their life goes on after they leave you. And it makes you sad, yet you rejoice in the life that they now have. And I think about that too, and I think particularly as a historian of things in our country's history that I think have really poisoned the church. I think of things like the Cold War. I think of things like the culture wars and all the things that came out of the Vietnam War. I think of the Carter presidency that led to this tremendous desperation and anger about the oil crisis in the Middle East and the Reagan Revolution that came after that. And I think of 9/11. And what I think of is a church that has become very defensive, very afraid, very angry, and very nationalistic. And I don't think any of those things have really served the church very well. I think where we need to live as Christians is with this Bible verse. For me to live is Christ. What a positive and a wonderful thing. What is there to be afraid of? And when I die, I get something even better. And so I think sometimes we don't put our best face forward when we're out in the world. We come off as, well, frankly, the way the media often portray Christians. Because all too often, that is how we look. And so I think we could think a lot more as Christians about how we put ourselves out in the world.
Would you be willing for those of us who don't know you as well, your life in a nutshell?
That's always dangerous. Born and raised in Northwest Iowa, came here as a freshman in the fall of 1979, started as a DCE student. I was in Glad Sound, which was the college band that went out every summer and played in churches, and of course tried to recruit students to come to Concordia. And during that summer, I decided I was going to be in pre-seminary. So I changed my major. The last part of my junior year, got engaged to a girl from my hometown who was a Baptist. And when I went to the seminary, that was not a good thing. So that did not end well. Neither the engagement nor my time at the seminary ended well. So I left, I came back to the Twin Cities, I did theater at night, worked in a machine shop, really edifying stuff. And ultimately, Jeff Burkhardt gave me a call in 1988 and said, Paul, I'm finishing my dissertation, I need somebody to run the AV Center for me. And Glenn offered me, would like you to run the front desk of the library. So how about if you come and interview for the job? Interview for a job you've already told me I have. Okay, all right, great. And while I was working as a staff person, got first my master's and my doctorate from Concordia. So went from staff to part-time faculty to full-time faculty to tenure-track faculty to chair of faculty senate to now dean of the College of Arts and Letters. I thought it was really funny, one of my former professors said, Paul, I remember you as a student. And I thought, there's a young man who's going to go far. I can see I was wrong. because I never really left Concordia except for a brief time. So this has been my home in many ways for many years. I'm okay with the fact that maybe I didn't get that far.
Gone a long way to say this. I've seen you minister in many different season or an episode that was a favorite memory of the year and then maybe a challenging episode as well.
Oh boy. I don't know if I talk about those things here.
Sure.
I just think in general, the faculty, when I was a student here for this second, caring people, Christian people, people who took as much of an interest in my personal life, not in a bad way, as in my life as a student, people who were role models, people who made me want to be a college professor when I grew up. I think of Herb Trifle, who's no longer with us, who is just such a wonderful, godly man, and his wife, Emmy, who's a powerful, formidable woman. Don't ever mess with Emmy. But she's just a wonderful person, great role model, a powerful individual in the community as well as in the church. I think of Bob Cole. I think of Fred Bartlett, Jeff Burkhart, Paul Marshley. Really more people than I can think of. I think the challenging part, both in ministry and in Concordia, is trying to be true to who you are while trying to adapt to how quickly things change around you. And that's something that I think we all understand on some level. The hard thing there is that all of us have a very clear sense of what we think is the right thing to do. But we don't all agree. I'm going to guess even in this room, where we are gathered to praise God, as a united family, if you ask us about certain things, we might vehemently disagree about them. And there's a quote from Reinhold Niebuhr that I used a couple of years ago that I always try to keep in mind, and that is, arguments are never between righteous people and sinners. They're always between sinners. And so if we can always stop to remember that we don't have a monopoly on the truth. Just because we're using the Bible passage to justify what we're saying, doesn't mean that we're right and someone else is wrong. Because maybe they have a Bible passage too, and then, oh my goodness, where are we? And so thinking about how all of these things fit together, thinking about how, well, Scripture should interpret itself. So if I use this in isolation, is that in harmony with other things that I find in Scripture as well? And if indeed I have to love my neighbor as myself, shouldn't I at least listen to this person in the same way that I want to be listening to? So I think in any situation, that's a challenge that we can all seek to overcome in a Christian and a humble way.
Many of you know that Dr. Hillmer is a twins fan. He has demonstrated his faithfulness and long-suffering as well. And not that it's an exact correlation, because we've got so many chapters of success in twins history. But as you have done so many different positions, seeing the ups and downs and the ebb and flow of Concordia over the years, both financially and economic-wise, student-wise, enrollment-wise, and now people are Concordia to now. It's a very different spot than when you were a student or when you were first employed here. Last question, what would you say would be your hopes and dreams for Concordia at going forward?
Well, there are a lot of different pieces to that question. I think going back to what I said before, finding a place of peace in the midst of the storm. Higher education as a product, and I hate that word, but nonetheless, it is seen more and more as a product, is a part of the discussion that I don't think anyone really likes, and yet it is a reality in our country today, probably in our world today. That we have seen such a tremendous economic upheaval. We've seen massive growth in tuition costs, but not massive growth in the incomes of American families. We've seen all these things that have made it harder and harder to go to school. And yet, in the midst of that, I'm sure that everyone at this university, faculty, staff, students, board of regents members, everyone, would like to see is that same sense of family, that same sense of community, that same sense of belonging, that same sense of soul, if you will, that has always made this a special place. But how do you do that while still serving all of these other constituencies, all these other demands, whether it be increasing government regulation, whether it be more of a sense of seeing school as a product with a price tag as opposed to an experience that transforms us? Those are all very difficult parts of the equation, and my hope for the board is that
me to live as Christ and to die as Him. Let's close with prayer. Lord, I thank you for Tuesday's here chaplain today. I thank you for Dr. Paul Hillmer and his ministry recording in many forms over the years. And I ask your blessings as he is now with you. I thank you for his ministry, his musical skills, his contributions to the Concordia, to the congregations of which he has served. Most of all, this day, Lord Jesus, as we gather for devotions in your name, remind us that you loved us so much that you died on the cross, so that we live in your name, that we live in you, that because of your love for us, we are sent to live forgiven so that others may know you as well. Send us, Lord, this day to live forgiven and share that love with our friends and family members. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.